sitting on your camera, then it got stuck.
It was
red. It was green. It was just red.
It probably even more rustic. It's just a little different. So
stops. So that means I got to come up here. Well, it's good to see everybody this morning. Hopefully you've had a good week so far. You've been able to rest and get done what you need to get done. Feel like you've accomplished something this week. It's always good to feel that way. I guess I shouldn't say this week. Last week, because this week starts today, right? Well, today is Mother's Day. We are grateful to be able to celebrate that and dote on our moms and our wives that have children, and we're grateful to be able to celebrate in those ways. And again, I'm sure all of you have stories you're thinking about. If your mom's with you still today, you'll talk with her. If she's gone on to be with the Lord and has passed, then you've got good memories to remember as well, and it's always good to have those. But I wanted to say Happy Mother's Day from the pulpit, and we're so grateful for all the hard work is an understatement, I guess I could say, that gets put into that. And I also want to say as well, our girls get mothered by everybody here too, in every which way. Not everybody has kids, but they get mothered, and we really appreciate that. So, and that being said, we have in the back, we're not going to pass them out, but we have a gift for all the ladies here this morning. It's back on the foyer table. What kind of flower is it again?
Mandevilla.
A mandevilla. You can see what that looks like back there. I don't know. I saw them because they were in my house. But okay. It's right here. This is what it will look like when it grows. It's in your bulletin there. But that is for all the ladies there. Go ahead and get that and pick it up. It's also in a container that can be planted. You don't have to take it out of that little pot. It'll be planted in that. It's just fine. But I wanted to give something for you that will last. It can go out in the yard. I don't know. Does it have any particular thing we need to mention as far as sun?
I'll have instructions on Wednesday.
Okay, yeah. Wednesday night, we'll get some instructions for you for specifics on that. But if it gets some sun and gets some water, it'll probably last until then, I'd say. So, well, again, happy Mother's Day to all the moms here. And be sure to tell your mother that if she's still with us. And reminisce of the good memories that you've made with them and on the day as well. And, of course, we're not going to have an evening service this evening. That way you can spend some time being there around your mom and devoting some time there and spending time with your wives, husbands as well. So, and then as far as our other announcement that we have is in the bulletin, it's Memorial Day service, so it's another few Sundays away. But we'll have the main service in the morning, and in the evening we're going to have a cookout. Phil's going to help me bring my grill down here. It's nothing impressive, but it'll grill a hot dog or hamburger. So we'll have that here, and we'll enjoy some time like that. We'll have maybe some singing and some a service of sorts, but it'll be more low-key than normal. And again, no Sunday evening service this Sunday, and then we look forward to that next Sunday. You have to forgive my throat. It's being bothered by something. Allergies or cold or something, so I'll do my best to sing out loud. If you'll turn with me now to page 386, we'll sing our first song. We'll stand together and sing Revive Us Again. We praise Thee, O God, for the Son of Thy love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. Hallelujah, Thine the glory. Bowles, would you open us in a word of prayer this morning?
Father, we come to you and thank you for this day that you have provided for us to open your word. We just pray now that you might be with all the mothers here. We thank you for them. We know they have supported the family in many, many different ways. We thank you for them. We pray for the ones that are not here today. We just pray you might be close to them as they to celebrate Mother's Day and being around family. We just thank you for that. We just pray now as we open your word today that you might speak to us through your loving servant here, that you might show us what you have for us this day. And we ask all these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. We can turn over to our next Psalm, 516. 516, we have an anchor. We're going to sing the first, the third, and the fourth on this.
Will your anchor hold in the storms of life? When the clouds unfold their wings of strife? When the strong tides lift and the cables strain, will your anchor drift?
singing. At this time, we'll have our men come up, take of our tithes and offerings this morning. Father, we're so grateful that you can give us an opportunity to give back to you, Lord, in our tithes and offerings as we give, Lord, cheerfully from your heart as the New Testament commands us to do so. Father, we pray that you'd use these tithes and offerings to glorify your name, Lord, here in our community, in our church, Lord, and as well as the church abroad as we support many churches abroad, Lord. We're so grateful for this opportunity to worship you in this way, Lord, and have done with the monies as you would see fit. In Christ's name, amen. Hastening to him this morning. All right, our last song. We'll get our hymn of the month out and our new song here. I practiced a little bit on those triplets this week, so we'll see if I can get through them or not. If you're not, just bear with me. By the end of the month, I'm going to have it down, just like everyone else here. So, got your hymn of the month there with you. If you'll stand, we'll sing as we read your holy word. As we read your holy word, help us see, Lord, help us learn. Holy Spirit, from its pages, lead the way. Come and melt our stubborn will, make our hearts and souls be still. As we singing. This time we have that a special this morning. It's our girls are going to sing one of the songs they sang in Puerto Rico when they were able to go down there. And Shea is going to play her guitar. She's been practicing faithfully on that. All three have been practicing and working hard, but I'll leave it at that.
Just when all
should go ask them something in Spanish now. Thank you, ladies. Thank you, Dana, for playing this morning. Well, last week we didn't finish our time in Galatians looking at what's expected of the believer. We've seen the... The law of Christ is mentioned several times in the New Testament. Again, by as I typically do as we get into books like Galatians, it's good to keep the theme of what's going on in our minds because it makes sense of what's being said. It's important to do that. It's always important to know and remember the context that a verse is in so that you're careful not to take it out of context. You're careful not to try to apply something that really doesn't apply to a certain situation at a certain time or to you at all. We don't have problems keeping things in context when we read in Leviticus about the different practices that were commanded by God in worshiping Him. No one's sacrificing animals anymore. We're not expected to do so because we understand that that aspect has been fulfilled. And of course, reading from this passage here this morning, we understand the context to be this. Paul writes to the Galatians after he had led them to the Lord, established a church, and established a church with good doctrine. And they were swept away by false doctrine that had come in. This was a young church at the time of this letter being written. It had been around for a little bit. Again, like I said, it had been established in Scripture, with Scripture. But because false teaching came in, took advantage, false teachers came in to take advantage of the group that were meeting in Galatia and to confuse them and to bring about a yoke of bondage in their life. And that's why it's so important. Again, I can't mention it enough that we have to be reading our Bibles constantly so that we know what God expects of us. And we begin to memorize it. The more you read it, the more you just inadvertently at times memorize. I know where that's at. That's here in Scripture. That's coming out of the Psalms, or that's coming out of the book of Revelation, or that's coming out of Ephesians, or so forth. But it's good to have that so you do not get led away, led astray. A young believer, because that was the majority of the people here, needs someone there to help them become established. And Paul didn't abandon them when he left. He established them with someone that could carry on. But nonetheless, these false teachers, these Judaizers, came in and brought about a yoke of bondage to try to follow the law again. To follow the law for salvation and to follow the law for their sanctification in Christ, or their progressively becoming more like Him, as Romans 12, 1 and 2 speaks of clearly. But instead of the law of Moses, the Christian today is called to live according to the law of Christ. And where the law of Moses had very rigid expectations, it's not that God doesn't have standards and rigid or expectations of us that need to be followed to the letter. It is not, again, about making ourselves holy. As we get into this passage, it's a very familiar passage, chapter 5 of Galatians, verses 22 through 26. We get into the part where it speaks of the fruit of the Spirit. And it's important to know that that is God's work in the life of the believer and not the work of the believer in their own abilities. And yes, it is Mother's Day. I'm not forgetful of that. I didn't prepare anything in particular. I didn't run to Proverbs 31. That's a good, wonderful psalm. Wonderful, or proverb, excuse me, to look at and to use as a guide for your life. And there's many other passages. I heard something, I don't remember where I heard it. I heard it at, it may have been a meme on Facebook. I don't know, but something like that. But you have different women in the Bible, and this one You know, I'm going to butcher it. I'm not even going to try it. We have many women to follow in Scripture. I think of Hannah, for one, Samuel's mother. You think of Deborah. We just went through Deborah and her taking charge because someone needed to. What about Jael? And not necessarily, there's no indication that she was a mother, but she did some pretty amazing things there in dealing with Sisera. In the process, these are examples that you can draw conclusions from. But again, this morning we're not looking at individuals. I'm not going to try to trace the life of a woman or a mother in Scripture this Mother's Day. But what we have here is a list of the fruits of the Spirit. And I think everybody can logically understand that this is given to every single believer. But as in a way of exhortation this morning, these are encouraging for you as a mother as well. Mothers aren't expected to be perfect. God never asked anybody to be perfect. But what you are expected to do is try for the glory of the Lord as you raise your children. And as I said even earlier, I know there are some here this morning who haven't been blessed with having children. The Lord decided that wasn't going to be a part of their life, but you have influence in the lives of others and children. And especially in our context here in our church, I've already said it once, but most of the women have a motherly relationship with our daughters, and we truly appreciate that. It means so much to us. But again, Scripture doesn't command you to be perfect. You're going to fail at times, and that's all right. Just don't quit. Keep moving. But these are the marks that every believer aims for, but as well, mothers. Think about this in light of your interaction with your children today as we go through some of these things. I did not give another handout this morning. It is the same if you did keep or if you brought your handout from last week, it'll just be the remainder of that. If not, you can take notes on your bulletin or on your hand, wherever you see fit. So why don't we read through the whole passage this morning? I don't have them up here like that on the screen because this is a different format, but we're going to start in verse 22 of Galatians chapter 5, reading down to verse 26. It says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Now, those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. Let us not become boastful, challenging one another, envying one another." Again, part of the our context, the Jewish law that was being pushed upon, or the Mosaic Law, pushed upon these believers in Galatia as a form of holiness or righteousness or sanctification before God. And they were seeing the impossibility of that because it was made to be impossible to completely hold. Then the fear that needed to be addressed by those believers who were okay with this, we'll say legalism. This legalism in our culture today, the term, and especially church culture, that has a little bit of different meaning behind it and a different push. But these believing individuals from the sect of the Pharisees were fearful, as we've talked about on multiple occasions so far, is being lawless. What does the Gentile need to do so that they do not fall back into or continue a life of lawlessness, living to serve self and the flesh and not to separate themselves to God? Because the law allowed that to happen, Mosaic law. And now we get what is coined as the law of Christ in chapter 6, verse 2. This is what we do. This is the standard that we hold. Again, recognizing the power and the work of God over and above your own abilities and capabilities. So our third blank in this series is this. Remember, you crucified your flesh. You crucified your flesh. You do not go after sinful things because you crucified your flesh. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. In the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. That's why I'm not lawless, is because I've crucified my flesh with Christ and I live by faith and not by sight. Verse 22 starts this list of guideposts for the believer. Says this, but the fruit of the Spirit is. Again, sometimes conjunctions like the word but can be, you know, what's going on? You know, you've heard the statement, everything you say, and then you insert the word but, everything you said before the word but just gets completely done away with. There's no point in even have said it. That's not the case here. It does occur sometimes. I love you, but. It's good, fathers and husbands. Don't do that today. Don't make that statement. But here we have the conjunction but to show a contrast. The deeds of the flesh, as were mentioned before in verses 19 and 20, now the deeds of the flesh are evident, which are immorality, impurity, and sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, disputes, dissensions, factions, envying, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. But the fruit of the Spirit. Here, this believer should exhibit what follows. The next important thing to understand is, we're going to jump into the list here in a moment. Important thing to understand is this next phrase, the fruit of the Spirit. Whose fruit is it? The Spirit's. The fruit of the Spirit. I mentioned it last week in closing, I think. But it's important to understand this is a singular fruit. It's the fruit of the Spirit, not the fruits of the Spirit. When we make that a plural fruits, here's where our human nature, our sinful nature, tends to want to go. I can be loving and joyful and peaceful. Patience, not my thing. You're going to have to just deal with me because I'm not a very patient person. Faithful, yeah, I struggle there. I'm just, you know, not faithful to one another, but being faithful to God. But I think also faithfulness to one another and is a very important thing. That's what happens when we make it a plural fruits. I can keep some of them because, hey, this is a grove of trees bearing multiple fruits. No, this is the fruit. The definite article there, the, implies the singularness as well. The fruit of the Spirit. Every believer that is not doing the deeds of the flesh must have these aspects in their life. Must have the fruit of the Spirit, and they all must be occurring if you're maturing. Another important aspect of this is, again, it is the Spirit's work in this. How many of you know that the fruit tree, in all of its might, doesn't stand there if it's in a field or whatever, with his own power, straining to pop a fruit out on its branch on its own? Let me get this. Come on. I got to make an apple here. Got to do everything I can to get this apple out here. If that was the case, you'd see a whole bunch of shaken trees all the time trying to produce fruit from the stress that they're putting themselves under. That's not the way the fruit of the Spirit works. Trees produce fruit when they're in the right soil. They're nourished properly. They're watered properly. And they're getting the right amount of sunshine and so forth. And I think we would understand how we... It doesn't say that here, obviously, in the passage, but we see that there as well. Because the fruit of the Spirit is much more than an apple tree or so forth. And it's a lot more difficult to exhibit the fruits of the Spirit when you aren't being... Fruit of the Spirit, excuse me. Somebody taught me wrong at some point in time in my life, and I've got to get it out of my head. Fruit of the Spirit. We have to be in the Word of God. We have to be in fellowship with the Lord and with others. There's your if I am allowed to analogize it in that way, the proper soil and the proper water. Being in the right place will be a part of that fruit-bearing aspect. We don't attend church because we're commanded to in Hebrews. That's not the reason that we attend church. It's an exhortation not to do that, but we come because we have to, we need to. It's desperate for us to be in a place so that we hear doctrine, so that we get the encouragement that we need and the rebuke that we need and so forth, so that we are maturing in Christ as we should be. So we see the fruit is the work of the Spirit, but it comes about when we're in the right place. And like I said earlier, not being a plural thing, but a singular thing. If we are fruitful Christians, then we will be loving and joyful and peaceful, having peace even, patient, kind, good, faithful, gentle, self-controlled. Those things will be there. And of course, we work on those things. Those are aspects. There's other passages of Scripture where it talks about adding to certain things. Add to your patience, kindness, and add to your, you know, but that's not what's going on here. Because I can tell you, there are plenty of loving people who just aren't patient at every occasion. Or plenty of loving people who don't always have peace. Of course, these things, we grow in these. But if we're looking for a law to have, to follow, and I'm careful saying that, because the standard that we follow is Scripture's standard, not our own. If we're trying to look to follow something, follow these things, I must be more loving. I must be more joyful and so forth. Allow the Spirit to have that work in your life and exhibit these fruits, if you would. It's God's work in our lives. And of course, as that applies to mothers, the application is not much different. But think about this as you interact as a mother, or maybe you're a grandmother now. I wonder if you're not, as you're interacting with people and you have an influence over them, love and joy and peace, show these so that the God of the Bible may be glorified in your lives. Okay, in these verses, these guideposts, let's just take a few moments to kind of dig into the meaning of each word. It's important. As you got lists like this, don't make any sense if you don't know what they mean. The word for love here is the word that we get, is the Greek word agape. There's three, if I'm not mistaken, words that are used in Greek, not all in the Bible, but in Greek, for love. This one is the greatest form of that. It's self-sacrificial love. It's the love of Christ on the cross. There's brotherly love. You remember that conversation between Jesus and Peter right after he had denied him and the Lord was crucified and he rose again and he came and confronted Peter. Do you love me? Peter responds, do you agape me, Peter? Peter's response was, I phileo you. It's a love, but it's a friendship love. It's a love, but not quite self-sacrificial. But this love that the Spirit exhibits is a self-sacrificial love, an agape love that is best pictured by Christ. So that's what this aspect of the fruit of the Spirit is. Next, it says joy. Joy. Ultimately, and I know if you spend any time in church, most preachers or pastors have talked about joy and compared it to happiness. There's a distinction between the two. I don't have a problem with that distinction. But ultimately, joy is that which is not determined by your environment or the circumstances that you're in. Your joy doesn't get truly affected by the outside world. It can try to attempt to take your joy from you. It can try to do that. Sin will do such things. I go back carefully to the Old Testament with David as he, in Psalm 51, when he, in that psalm, where he's writing to the Lord, confessing to the Lord his sinfulness against Uriah, against Bathsheba, and with Bathsheba. And there he says, Lord, restore to me the joy of my salvation. And David's joy was removed because of sinfulness. So it can become a problem, but as we know, as a believer, we have the power to have victory over sin. We're not condemned to it. We're not in bondage to it. So a sinful behavior, don't get into those behaviors so that it doesn't try to taint and affect the joy that the Spirit can produce in your life. And joyfulness is not always walking around with a smile and a skip in your step and having a nice thing to say to everybody all the time. Part of that's personality. That's not always my personality. Sometimes I'm that way. Sometimes. An interesting fact about me, I don't know if it's way with every diabetic, I got two extremes. When my blood sugar gets high, typically I'm a lot more short-tempered. So that is obviously a problem. and I have to watch it because it's a hormonal-based disease. But when my blood sugar is low, I can be ridiculous. And I sometimes I don't realize it until someone says up to me or something. But I get a little bit more giddy as a person. And that's where my connection with joyfulness is there. I may have a hop in my step. And if it looks unusual, the girls are like, "Dad, is your blood sugar low?" Yeah, I probably need something to drink. I'm a little bit more grumpy than this normally. So let me take care of that joyfulness that's not really joyfulness. But joyfulness doesn't have to exhibit itself in the sense of skipping the step, hopping the step, just always bright and shining face and so forth. That's not the definition there. Next, peace. Peace. The only way to have peace is to be at peace with God, of course. And we are at peace with God, again, if we're saved. If we're not doing or fulfilling the deeds of the flesh, we would be at peace with God. But we also exhibit that. Many times, I've heard different testimonies, I should say it this way, of people who work, Christians, believers, faithful believers, who work in an environment where stressful things come up, or maybe a stressful thing has personally come up for that person, and they say, "How is it that you can be at peace when this is going on in your life or this is going on right now? How is it that you can exhibit joy in that? How is it that you can show love in those things?" And it's because of the fruit of the Spirit. It's a wonderful testimony to be at peace when the world is falling apart around you and on top of you sometime. It is a difficult thing. But it is possible if God is your God, if Jesus is your Savior. Next, patience. We don't want to spend too much time on this one, do we? This is only possible because you have personally experienced the patience of God. Our minds go back to that. And many times when we want to be impatient, the Spirit will say, "What is God with you? Look where you're struggling, and it seems to be consistent here, and God just patiently waits for you to turn back to Him." Patience. Kindness. Kindness is the idea of being helpful or beneficial to others. Helpful or beneficial to others. Being kind. Be going out of your way. And ultimately, the Spirit exhibits that with a person who stopped thinking about themselves primarily and thought of others. At times, your kindness has to be shown because you've got to do something that you maybe don't want to do or that's difficult for you and helpful for another individual. But that's what we are expected to be. These are the fruits that are expected to be in the life of every Christian. And of course, if you see this as you're going through these, there's something that's not there, I would encourage you at that very moment when you realize it, pray, "Lord, help me there. I'm not doing this like I should be, and I need your help." Again, therein lies the comfort of this fruit not being something that you're making happen on your own, because you can say, "You know what, I'm not the boss in this situation, but I've realized a failure. God, do something with me. Help me. Fix me." And there is the love of the Lord, and He will do that. Next, goodness. Of course, this is goodness towards others as we exhibit that, not just, you know, wholesome goodness of you're just a good old person, a good old guy or gal. Goodness is sometimes defined as generous, being generous. And we can be generous in many ways. We can be generous in our finances. We can be generous in our time. We can be generous in our knowledge on things. If we're, for the believer, being generous as you share the Word of God with others and you teach them. Mothers use that frequently as well as they teach their children. Obviously, it's a if I use the word team effort there with a mother and a father as they raise their children. But you bring them up in the fear and the admonition of the Lord. You're generous with that time that you give them to raise them, as opposed to being a person who's just thinking about themselves. You're generous with your knowledge as you train up a child in the way that they should go, and they will not depart from it when they are older. The seventh one mentioned, is faithfulness. We are faithful because He is faithful. This is possible. He is always our example, God, that is. He always shows His faithfulness, and that should be a reminder to us to be faithful. But as we exhibit those fruits as well of faithfulness, just like I said, I read in chapter 2, verse 20, about being crucified with Christ. We live by faith now. And living by faith, of course, means being faithful. That is expected of every believer, and it is such a great example to those around you, as you are faithful. Next, gentleness. Gentleness. Gentleness is occasionally referred to as humility, being humble. I'm not sure. The King James has meekness in this list. Is that? Do you have gentleness or meekness in your Bible? It's not absolutely necessary. Shout it out if it's there. I know the term is there. I don't know if it correlates with gentleness here. But ultimately, gentleness is humility. Of course, thinking of others as opposed to thinking of yourself. That may be a hard task that I just assigned to y'all. It is? Gentleness and meekness? Okay. Many times meekness has been defined as gentleness, but as power under control. Being under control, and we'll see that in the next one as well. But being gentle, as I've said a few times already, is being humble before others, not being arrogant, not being prideful, but being humble before others and before the Lord. And of course, we're able to do that because we see the prime example of Christ as He humbled Himself and took on the form of a servant in Philippians chapter 2. And finally, the last of the list of the fruit of the Spirit is self-control. Self-control. If you think about all these fruits, there's an extreme contrast of the deeds of the flesh. Self-control speaks of self-restraint on multiple different levels, especially against previously mentioned self-abandonment. You're not self-abandoned, but you're self-controlled. You're able to take whatever comes at you and deal with it humbly, in a loving way, in a patient way, keeping your joy and being at peace, gentle and kind. But self-control is allowing the Spirit to be in control ultimately. And finally, though it's not a fruit in particular, it says against such things there is no law. Against such things there is no law. Even the best of the unsaved world know that these fruits, if they were to sit down and read them, they would say, like many unsaved people do, they pick up Scripture and say, these are good moral standards to live by. But even the unsaved, the best of the unsaved world know that these fruit are good. This fruit is good. And of course, the lost Jew and the lost Gentile would have recognized those things. As Paul wrote this letter, and if it got into the minds of those believing sect of Pharisees, they would have said, you know what? If the Spirit was working in their heart, this is much better than the laws that we are trying to push upon them. Number one, because it doesn't make a person have to be capable of doing these things on their own. It puts God at the forefront. And next, it, if we're exhibiting these fruits, we become much more aware of the world around us and less self-centered and more self-sacrificial. But against such things there is no law. These virtuous fruit are not a law in themselves. Like I said, we didn't just replace the Mosaic law with another law, a legalism to follow. That's not what's going on. And again, primarily that's tied up in that, but the fruit of the Spirit, the work of God in the life. And of course, as we tie in the principles of faith that's been mentioned before, these things don't speak to a law that has to be kept, but a law that can be kept because of God. So they don't speak of a law in and of themselves. One cannot be saved by maintaining these things. And one can't become more holy by maintaining these things. That is all the work of God. And ultimately, this is the answer that the Lord gave Paul to give to the Pharisees who were afraid of lawlessness. This is what you do. You show love. You show joy. You show peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And these will keep you from self-abandonment, from lawless behavior, and will cause you to live for Christ. So consider this. God never called us to hold a position of perfection on our own. And at times I know, again speaking specifically to mothers this morning, you feel like you got to do that. I got to just always have everything right. I've got to have the house has got to always be spotless, and I've got to always have the kids at their things on time, and the dinner's got to be ready, and all this kind of stuff. And it's a burden that you really don't need to bear, and if your husband expects it, you should probably slap him. And say, how about you help me vacuum every once in a while, or do something like that. I understand moms at times bring that burden of perfection upon themselves. Don't burden yourself with that. Just be like Christ, and that's what's be the most beneficial. Exhibit these fruits, and then you will be a witness to those around you. The fruit of the Spirit only comes by surrender and allowing Him to move in your life. Verse 24, now those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with His passions and its desires. With His passions and desires. This is a simple statement of fact. It is also keeping our mind in the right place. Now, those who belong to Christ, obviously speaking to believers, belong to Christ Jesus, they have crucified the flesh. That's why you don't follow the deeds of the flesh. It has been put to death. And of course, the passions and lusts that are defined in the deeds of the flesh. Moving on, and we'll close with this morning. Verses 25 and 26. Know that freedom takes surrender. Know that freedom takes surrender. Our flesh doesn't want to surrender. But if we are truly going to be free in Christ, we have to give all to Him. Verses 25 and 26 say this. For we live by the Spirit, if we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. Let us not become boastful, challenging one another, envying one another. Paul starts by saying, if we live by the Spirit, something to remember. It's not a question, per se, if the believer has the Spirit, but it's a statement. If this is true, if we live by the Spirit, we do have the very power of God residing in us. We are capable of not living for self, but by walking by faith. We are alive because of the Spirit's work of baptism. Now we need to live by the Spirit. It goes on, let us also walk by the Spirit. So again, you live by the Spirit. Statement of fact. A statement of fact. The let us walk by the Spirit is called a hortatory subjunctive. And what that means, most of the time a subjunctive, so it's a mood, if you want to call it in grammar, is it shows possibility. This could or could not happen. This may or may not happen. But when it's written in the way that it is, it's actually it's an encouragement or it's an exhortation. So if you live by the Spirit, then you are exhorted. Let us also walk by the Spirit. Let us walk by the Spirit. I'll take a moment to discuss what this means for us. Let us walk by the Spirit. Let us walk in the Spirit. It's critical to understand that word walk here. Paul's used the word before. We walk by faith, not by sight. But it's a different word than the word that he translated walk, or that we've translated walk in those other statements. This word here really means to follow. To follow. To be in line with a person or thing. To consider, or a thing considered as a standard. So let me read that again, sorry. To be in line with a person or thing considered as a standard for one's conduct. That's what walk is there. To hold to something, to agree with, to follow, or confirm. If we live by the Spirit, which we do as believers, let us follow the standard of the Spirit. Let's follow the move of the Spirit, which were the things just mentioned. There's the expectation there. And again, it's walking by the Spirit, not by yourself. And ultimately, the question comes up is, if we live by the Spirit, again, that's what we are. We are Spirit-indwelt people as His church. Do you hear His voice? If you are expected to walk by the Spirit, to follow the standards of the Spirit, do you hear His voice? Have you cluttered up mess in your life that prevents you from hearing that? Sinful habits and lifestyles, lies, false teaching, where it prevents you from actually hearing what God tells you and convicts you about in His Word. Only you can answer that. He moves, He directs, He convicts. He brings comfort, but He also brings discomfort when things need to change. But the question is can you hear Him? So if I was to retranslate this verse, I'd put it this way. If we live by the Spirit, let us follow the standards of the Spirit. If we live by the Spirit, let's follow the standards of the Spirit. Finally, verse 26, let us not become boastful, challenging one another, envying one another. Another encouragement to let us there. Strongly encourage, if those previous things are true, then let's not be like the world. Let's not become boastful. Let's not fight amongst one another, which is, again, a deed of the flesh. Pride, of course, we know is a great sin. It's what seems to indicate the fall of Lucifer himself was the sin of pride. And not envying one another for things that others have that you want. Boastfulness is really something that lacks glory. It's vain glory, as it's translated, I want to say again, in the King James. Empty glory, that without any value. Challenging one another is calling each other out. Being at strife, doing the deeds of the flesh. And again, one more time, envying one another. Because when envy sets in, it's because you're not content with what the Lord has done for you. If we are to live as Christians, we are to live by the law of Christ, not the standard that was set by through Moses. So how to walk here? We close with this morning. Let the Spirit work in you. Let the Spirit do His job. Battle the flesh by the power of the Spirit, which implies not trying to do it on your own. Battle the flesh by the power of the Spirit. And finally, remember, victory is secure when you walk by the Spirit. Victory is secure. And all these things apply to every believer. And again, as a special exhortation this morning for mothers, let these fruits be exhibited so that your family sees that, your husbands see that, and your impact upon them. Impact others that you have involvement and interaction with in your life by exhibiting the fruits of the Spirit, letting the Spirit work and produce these things. Let's close in a word of prayer. Father, thank you so much for the opportunity that we have to be here today, Lord, the chance that we could be in fellowship around your word, Lord, but also celebrate mothers and those who act as mothers, Lord, and involve in the lives of others, Lord, in a kind way. I pray that you give them a special blessing today. Lord, take us home safely. Let us take time to spend with our mothers and our wives and dote on them as much as we can as husbands. and his children. Lord, we're grateful for that. Protect us as we go out. And Lord, bring us back safely on Wednesday evening as we come back around midweek to honor you and serve you through the word and praise you as well. In Christ's name, amen. Amazing Grace, sound good? I don't have a one. I can never remember what page that's on. We'll all stand and sing. We'll sing my favorite verse in this song. It's the last verse. Where is that at?
187.
Okay. 187. We'll sing the last verse of Amazing Grace. The power of the Spirit today, honoring the Lord, honoring your mothers and your wives, and enjoy your day. Hope you have a good evening this evening. Harold Dale, would you close us in a word of prayer?
Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the amazing grace, dear Father, that was sung about. And Father, I pray you'd help us with this message today, apply it to our heart and lives, and that we will have this fruit of the Spirit, Father, that we know through prayer and